and I have the great honor as serving on this task force as a chairperson. And I want to thank you all so much for being here. This is really an incredible showing of not just support for housing issues, but a real testament to the mayor's wise decision to create a task force to look at developing a comprehensive housing policy and a comprehensive housing policy plan. Thank you, Mayor, for being with us. Thank you to your staff for their incredible support. I also would like to recognize that we have with us the Honorable Councilwoman Mia Gran from District 3. Thank you, Councilwoman, for joining us tonight. We also have Cheryl Scholar, the City Manager. Thank you, Cheryl, for being here. Along with Deputy City Manager Peter Sinoni and many of the members of the staff. Thank you all for your support, for ensuring that we have the level of administrative and logistical support necessary to conduct tonight's meeting. And this is really a historic moment. And if you notice a little bit of nervousness in my voice, it's a combination of excitement for being at this table and really being in this room with all of you. I know that many of you and many of us have been working on these issues in our communities, with our respective agencies, in many capacities. And so I'm incredibly inspired, and I think we all are, to have you be part of this process. And before we dive into introducing the task force members, I would like to introduce our honorable mayor, who's had the wisdom to create this task force and who's prepared to share welcoming remarks with all of you. So without further ado, I'd like to introduce Mayor Ron Nuremberg.
Good afternoon, everyone, and welcome, and thank you, Louis, for the introduction. I won't take long, but just sharing some thoughts to get us started. I do agree with you, this is a historic moment, and judging by the level of interest in a policy framework on housing, as evidenced by the people who are here today, the number of people, this is long overdue. And it's not without its previous attempts, but I think that, first of all, the folks gathered here at the table to help us with this policy. The convening of this group is historic. The charge of this group, specifically on the issues that we've already named, from gentrification to rehabilitation to addressing the shortage of affordable homes in this community, is also historic. And so I first want to say thank you to the people who are present watching, and also to our task force members. You probably hear it in my voice. I'm struggling with the allergens and the mold that's in the air, so I apologize if I sound like I just woke up. I promise I didn't. I will try to make it through some brief introductory remarks. And before I do, there is an agenda. For those of you who are interested, there is an agenda. On the flip side of the English agenda, there is also in Spanish. And we want to be as cognizant of as possible about the accessibility and needs for folks who may be watching. I'm excited about the energy and interest our community has shown in wanting to tackle our housing challenges together. It's critical to the future of our city that we do this well and that we do it now. As some of you have heard me say, San Antonio will double in size by 2050. An additional million and a half people will be calling our home. San Antonio will be the size of Chicago. Over the next 20 years, we expect 500,000 new housing units to be built in San Antonio. How and where these homes are built will help shape this city's future, its quality of life, and the opportunities for all of its citizens. All San Antonians deserve to live with dignity, and our city should feature a diverse housing stock that is high quality, affordable, and sustainable. We must address the affordability challenges so that San Antonians can find quality places to live, regardless of their income level and regardless of which part of town they live in. Our housing must be affordable for all families of all sizes. for families of all sizes and market-driven. It should give residents the tools and opportunity to age in their homes, rehabilitate existing structures, and preserve the integrity of our neighborhoods. I have charged the task force with developing a comprehensive and compassionate housing policy framework to address the pressing housing challenges that our city faces, from availability and affordability to gentrification and displacement. This plan will align existing public and private resources and address issues of gentrification, displacement, and the need for rehabilitation of existing housing stock. The task force has autonomy to determine the process and level and time and place of community input gatherings, and we will do so to facilitate the objective of a comprehensive housing framework. I have complete faith in their abilities to execute a strategy that in 6 months will result in an action-oriented policy recommendation that the community will have an opportunity to vet and the City Council will have an opportunity to vote on. I want to thank the task force members for stepping up to this duty, including the task force chair, Luis Castro Ramirez, Jim Bailey, Maria Mary Zaval, Gene Dawson Jr., and Noah Garcia. I also want to thank everyone in the community that has shown an interest in participating and lending their expertise. The task force will develop technical working groups and many community members will be drafted to help problem solve around specific issues. The working meetings, like this one today, are open to the public, and designated community input meetings will also be scheduled so your voices can be heard. The Mayor's Housing Policy Task Force will work in tandem with the city and agency staff to develop policy recommendations and connect these recommendations to the city's SAMR comprehensive plan and with the vision of SA 2020. Regarding the Housing Commission, many have asked how its mission relates to that of this task force. The distinction is this. The Housing Commission oversees the long process of actual policy implementation under a council-approved work plan. The task force has a short-term, broad-based mandate to recommend what policies should be created in the future. I want to take this opportunity to thank the Housing Commission members for their ongoing commitment and for their hard work. We will be relying on their knowledge and expertise throughout this process. Thank you all for being here today, and thank you again to the task force members, to city staff, to Christine Drennan, and to our community members. And one last note, we've done a lot of heavy lifting over the last 3 months since this new administration took office. We passed a budget that is based on equity. We've had conversations that we probably previously wouldn't have had the courage to do. I place this in the same category. This will not be easy work. It will not be for the faint of heart. And in many ways, embarking on this journey right now is an acknowledgement that these are going to be some difficult conversations. So thank you to the City Council, to the city staff who have led us in this direction, that give us the confidence and the foundation to stand this task force onto. And we look forward to the productive results. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mayor. I also do want to announce that para personas que necesitan interpretación, tenemos servicios aquí atrás. For anyone that's needing translation, we do have, I should say, interpretation services. We do have interpretation services available. Carlos, do you want to make another announcement on that? Or
no, no, no. Sería enfatizar lo que dice, ¿no? Que con los que no pueden interpretar en español, están disponibles en la mesa de atrás.
Okay, gracias. Thank you, Mayor. So on the agenda, the next item is an opportunity for each of us as task force members to introduce ourselves. And I'm really delighted to work alongside Jean and Jim and Maria and Noah over the last 3 weeks. And we have been working to essentially prepare for this moment. And we have done so so much work that we each prepared a 3-minute statement. And so I'm going to go ahead and lead on, and then we'll turn it over to Jim, and then we'll go with Maria, and then we'll have Jean, and Noah. You'll be the last person if you're okay with that. All right, good. So Mayor, thank you again. Thank you again for the appointment to this task force. I very much appreciate your confidence. in my ability to serve as the chair and to work with these incredibly committed task force members, but also to work with the community and to work with various stakeholders who are interested in this issue. Thank you all for being here for our first housing task force meeting. In many ways, having this meeting on National Night Out is perfect. You know, this annual community building campaign, National Night Out, is about promoting neighbor-to-neighbor relationships. It's about building strong community partnerships, and it's about fostering safer and more caring places to live. I have dedicated pretty much my entire life to public service, striving to expand choice and opportunity for all persons, and recognizing that I have a special responsibility to address the needs of disadvantaged groups and individuals. I have primarily done this by working with individuals, with families, with communities, and institutions, and using housing as a catalyst for community building. I see myself and I see my family reflected in the families that I have worked with my entire life, working men and women that are trying hard to make it, families with children searching for a decent and affordable place to rent or to own, a place in neighborhood schools, not far from their job site, and in a safe and welcoming neighborhood. Individuals that want to belong and feel connected to their neighbors. During my time at the Department of Housing and Urban Development, where I had the honor of leading public and native housing programs across the country, I saw how cities and native communities are working on addressing housing shortages across the country and doing everything that is possible to stretch and multiply precious federal resources by leveraging private and philanthropic sector partners. With declining federal support for housing and community resources, such as CDBG and HOME, which many have occurred over the last 5 years, you know, the declines in these resources, now more than ever, local strategies are critically important. And as the mayor mentioned, since the announcement, there have been many questions about the purpose of this task force. And so we all recognize that there's a lot of critical work that is happening across the housing policy spectrum, from boards, commissions, community members that are engaged in their neighborhoods, committees, and significant ongoing physical planning to support our comprehensive plan. So let me try to clarify what we see as our purpose. We, the task force, have been tasked to lead a visioning process that will enable us to develop a comprehensive and compassionate housing policy framework that connects, aligns, and identifies missing pieces in these efforts, from homelessness to homeownership. We have been tasked to ensure that ongoing efforts and most importantly, we have a broad mandate to explore long-term housing policy implementation and funding strategies that support our collective drive towards an equitable future for all San Antonians. We also know that the demand for affordable housing, especially affordable rental housing, far outweighs the supply. So existing affordable housing
talk about a set of beliefs that I intend to apply to all the work and all the oversight that I do through this policy framework process. I believe that housing, as our visionary comprehensive plan says, is not a standalone concept. It's intertwined with our carbon footprint, our physical health, our education quality, transportation options, food access, cultural identity, economic bandwidth, and availability of city services. I believe that through smart growth policy implementation, we can utilize infrastructure deployment as a vehicle to mobilize the market forces and empower our nonprofits to confront the crisis we face. Through a significant, sustainable, and locally sourced funding stream for affordable housing and neighborhood resiliency, I believe that our banking sector is up to the challenge of shoring up homeownership in San Antonio, and in partnership with our nonprofit and for-profit developers, generating products for the creation of affordable housing opportunities or for housing opportunities that San Antonio can afford.
I believe that we as a community will choose to preserve our cultural resources, strengthen the integrity of our neighborhoods, challenge rising costs and historic inequity, and agree on a housing policy framework that provides access to opportunity, education, transportation, and good health with safe, decent, and affordable housing for all. I believe that to succeed, we must be transparent and inclusive and develop trust between the task force and our neighbors that we represent. What we face is a systemic problem that was decades in the making and will take decades to reverse. If the work of this task force is to be lasting, it's not we here at this table that will make it so. It's everyone around us and all the generations that will come after us. Finally, I believe that we can no longer look primarily to Austin and Washington for solutions when few are forthcoming. Rather, we must be smarter about how we use our resources and do what Americans do best, pull ourselves up by our bootstraps. We have the vision, we have the leadership, and the tools we need. Thanks to Mayor Nuremberg for giving me the opportunity to do my part, and thanks to our chair for her unerring guidance from day as we work through this initial organizational process.
I didn't think of introducing myself, but I think a good way to do it is today I got a phone call from one of the television stations, and the reporter wanted to interview me on affordable housing, and she said that she had done an interview with me 40 years ago on affordable housing. She remembered, so it was just my way out. So that's my introduction. I've been at it for a very long time, and I'm so glad to be here. Thank you, Mayor Nuremberg, for the creation of this housing policy task force that will develop a framework for a comprehensive and compassionate housing policy. Thank you for the confidence you placed in me to sit around this table. I look forward to working with our chair, Lourdes Castro Ramirez, Jim Bailey, Jean Dawson, and Noah Garcia. As you have spoken publicly, Mr. Mayor, about this task force, I appreciate your statements that reflect a comprehensive approach that we are to address. Housing affordability, neighborhood stability, gentrification, displacement, rehabilitation. When I see the problems in our older areas of our city resulting from disinvestment and lack of attention for generations, I realize that the task of solving these problems will be daunting. When I hear neighborhood and community leaders express concern and frustration over the challenges of growth in their neighborhoods, I see that our housing issues are diverse and complex. But many things encourage me. One is the public engagement and interest on the part of so many citizens. There are many people, many around here right now, who work tirelessly through neighborhood associations and community groups to improve the places where they live. I am also very encouraged by the City Council's commitment to addressing issues through equity lens, as was done in the last budget, and I am very cognizant of the staffing that it took to get you all to that place. Now it is time to address housing through equity lens too. One point I want to make to those residents who have taken time to attend this meeting, and those who will view the meeting online later, is that our task force wants to hear from you. Well, each of us has a unique view, one piece of housing, if you would, into the world of housing. All of us agree that we need the public to complete the circle. At this moment in time of our city, we will create the avenues for you to participate. I invite you to do so. Bring us your ideas and help us produce an excellent document that we can present to City Council. I also want to recognize the work of the city staff who are responsible for the daily delivery of housing services. And they do it whether there's a report or not. This recognition extends also to citizen volunteers who serve on our various housing committees, task forces, and commissions. There is a lot of work already being done. At the end, our journey together is to take advantage of this moment in the history of our city, a hopeful moment where housing for all has been lifted to a high priority, This is historic, Mr. Mayor. We want to make sure that the very basic need of all people to have decent, safe, affordable, and stable housing is a reality. And I want to end, as I began, with Mayor Nuremberg's words. Quote, "I believe in government that listens to you and is accountable to all whom it serves," end of quote. Our work, therefore, must be grounded in transparency, inclusion, and equity. And I am ready to start. Thank you.
I'm Gene Dawson, and when we think of infrastructure in the city, we think of streets, highways, water, and electricity. From a business community standpoint, there cannot be economic development without infrastructure. Available infrastructure based on long-term planning is a cornerstone of a successful city, and its importance is evident in the time spent by the business community advocating for these issues. However, today, another piece of our infrastructure is in crisis, and it is called affordable housing. As an example, and I'm an engineer, so I'll go to the numbers to make me feel comfortable. In 2006, we had over 19,000 new housing starts in the Bexar County area, and 7,500 of those were below $150,000. In 2010, we had 7,600 housing starts. 3,400 of those were below $175,000. Now in 2016, we don't even track new housing starts below $150,000, and we have 18% of our housing below $200,000. So you can see that we are moving in the wrong direction. And why would I bring up new housing, the cost of new housing? Because the inability to produce significant new housing below $150,000 in the existing housing stock feels the pressure. As prices increase, demand on existing houses increases. Demand is greatest on pricing in our older neighborhoods, with an appreciation of nearly 25% over the last 3 years. Some of this demand is filled by new multifamily construction, but at market rate far beyond affordable rent. Further putting pressure on our housing stock is deteriorating housing, which we need to remain viable for our community. San Antonio City staff, SA Tomorrow, the Housing Commission, and many, many others spend every day working on this evolving crisis. Most in the business community consider affordable housing as something addressed deep in the halls of the city planning department, by nonprofits, or by the federal government. I hope my participation on this task force will help alert the business community to this evolving affordable housing crisis and the threat to the city's economic success.
Thank you so much. I am honored to be part of this housing task force. Thank you, Mayor Nuremberg, for selecting me to be part of this very talented group of individuals that brings a wealth of knowledge. And I hope personally to bring my experience of 30 years of commercial banking, financing subdivisions that GE designs, to financing homes that are no longer affordable because of the price. It starts with the price of the lot. And our lot costs are creating housing costs that are way out of the reach of many people. So that experience, I believe, brings a great balance to this table. To my 2 years of being on the Commission of SAPA, where I had the honor of interviewing Lourdes and hiring Lourdes, and learning from her and really understanding the rent-burdened individuals in our community, understanding how that rent burden is now at 30%, but sometimes increasing to 50% now, and especially in rising costs. So it is, we are at a critical junction of really looking at this housing crisis that we're in. To working with the San Antonio Housing Commission, which Mayor Nuremberg appointed me to, that's doing great work and will continue to do great work, and where I have the honor of working with Jim and getting to know Jim. to work in the community, being on the Guadalupe Cultural Arts Board and chairing the Guadalupe Cultural Arts Center, and having family that had businesses that lived on the west side. So affordable housing is so important for us now and for our future. And I am glad that as a community, we are addressing this issue of rising costs and affordability before we price everybody out of the market. And that's where we're headed if we don't address affordability. And I've rolled up my sleeves along with the rest of this task force, and I'm ready to join those in the community that are ready to roll up their sleeves.
Thank you very much, everyone, and as was shared by the remarks from each of the task force members, we have been thinking about these issues for longer than the creation of the task force, and we are very committed to doing everything that we can to ensure that we develop a process that enables us to dive deeper into the policy areas. But we're also very committed to using this process as a process that will allow for us to raise a greater awareness about housing, greater awareness about the intersection between housing and education, and housing and health, and housing and jobs, and housing and just the ability to live in a sustainable neighborhood. And so today we kick off this meeting with a presentation by an individual that many of us have had the pleasure to work with, a professor and just an amazing woman who has been involved in a number of efforts. I first met actually Christine Drennan, Dr. Drennan from Trinity University when I was working for the Housing Authority and working with residents and a number of community stakeholders to launch the Choice and Promise Neighborhoods effort. And I know that over the summer, Christine Drennan had the opportunity to present, at the request of the mayor and the city council, a presentation that basically laid the foundation for what we are now sort of speaking about, the importance of looking at everything that we do, whether it's economic development or housing or even job creation, from an equity lens. And so I'd like to ask Dr. Drennan to please come and join us for this next portion of the presentation, for a presentation, Christine, that is titled Housing and Neighborhoods Through the Equity Lens. So let's give her a round of applause.
Nervous, but so honored to be here because I know that you had dozens of people who would like to give this talk as you begin this work, like the inaugural talk for the Housing Task Force. And again, I'm honored because, like I tried to say, my, let me get this to work. Hold on. This inaugural talk to begin your work. I don't have numbers, I don't have dates, I don't have statistics, and you will have lots of that. I am sure you'll have lots of that in the coming months. But what I share some histories and some insights and some encouragements about where we've been and about hopefully where we might go. What I'm going to try to do here is set the context for the statistics and all of the numbers that you'll get into so soon. We start here, we've heard this several times already, right? From availability and affordability to gentrification and displacement. And I'll look at those words in a little bit. But first, what I want to do is contextualize them. Just thinking about the vision, the vision and the mission of the city itself, right? I'm going to read all these words, don't worry. But just things that should hop out is that our vision is that we're healthy, we have quality education and economic opportunity, we're safe, we're engaged, it's sustainable, we have public transportation in downtown, right? We're engaged. And the mission is to get all of us there. It's a vision of prosperity for all, right? So one of my questions is, how does housing fit in that? Housing is private property, right? And this is the United States of America. So that is an honest, honest question, is how does housing fit in that? Right? Quality city services usually means libraries, roads, police protection, fire protection, waste removal, animal control, blah, blah, blah. Yet housing is not usually up there. So we need to figure out how does this come to be, right? And so in order to do that, I have a presentation. I have a lot of slides, but I have a presentation, and there's three parts, right? What's so special about housing? Why do we have a task force for housing? And how does it fit in that general articulation of the mission? And then if I can convince you that it is special, where do we start? Do we start with a blank slate? And then finally, what are our shared priorities? So what's so special? My housing, why do we have a task force for housing? Why do we have a task force like for lots of things, for driveways, for lots of sidewalks? We may. But housing is a catalyst. Housing is a catalyst toward opportunity. Right? And there's been so many studies done that says that if children are housed well, and this is my own work, if children are housed well, they're more likely to succeed in school. Toward health, and there's outcomes associated with higher levels of behavioral problems if you're not stable in a home. Right? Toward safety, neighborhoods with high levels of collective efficacy or that trust have lower levels of violence. Toward health, toward wealth, The ability to accumulate wealth in American society is very much based on our house, toward community, right? There's so many things that housing is actually really the basis of that we usually think of as social services, but so many of those are filtered through housing. And I have to add to that list as profit itself. Real estate and housing development has become extremely lucrative. So it is also an opportunity, and we need to be honest about that. So also, housing is also very unique. It's a very unique commodity, right? And I tell my classes, it's not like my shoes, right? Housing is very different for four reasons that I want to talk about really quickly. It's fixed, it has different forms of value, it's our savings account, and it's really, really expensive. So although it is private, it is privately owned, it is a private commodity, it's a very special commodity, right? For one thing, it is not just a house, right? It is not just a house. A house, because it's fixed, is part of a neighborhood. And neighborhood processes are different than just single houses. So this, I've got the one in the middle, that's my house. I just painted it bright pink. But I also am aware that it is a house in the neighborhood, right? And this is my neighborhood. So it sits. It's, you know, the fact that I, yesterday, like, painted my house bright pink impacts my neighbors. They're actually quite, they're pleased. They like it. But it does impact them. The decisions I make about my house, the upkeep on my house, impacts your house. Right? It's not like tomorrow when I change my shoes. They don't impact your shoes. But a house does. And so it's a very, very different kind of commodity. Housing has different forms of value, right? And again, housing has what we call use value and exchange value. A house is a home. A house is where I raise my family, it's where I keep my dog, it's my safe haven. But it also has an exchange value. I can sell it, I borrow against it for my kids, I hope to bequeath it to them, even maybe it won't be pink. But those two things depreciate at different rates. Right? And so sometimes when we try to communicate to one another about housing, some of us are talking about exchange value and some of us are talking about use value, and we need to be on top of both of those conversations, right? And need to recognize that both of those things are exquisitely and deeply important in this conversation, and that we can't just push use value especially to the side, right, in preference for exchange value. If anything, a lot of us are much more concerned about the use value. It's our savings account, right? For many of us, for most of the middle class in the United States, that our house is our savings account. That's how we accrue wealth, true wealth, not the money that I make in a paycheck, because that gets me through the week. But the wealth that I will then spend on my retirement and on my kids is accrued through my house. And it's really, really expensive. And it's becoming more expensive all the time. And because it's expensive, right? The entire housing stock cannot be provided by the private market. It just cannot anymore. And so we have to figure out, we, the public sector, have to figure out how the housing stock articulates with the local need, right? And this, and the numbers will come in at that point. If that's why it's important, my next question, part two, where do we start? Right, where do we start this whole conversation? Do we start here? Right, blank slate, new land, right? 142,000 units, we have all of these numbers, a million people are coming, all, you know, and can we just start new? And that's silly, that's ridiculous. So we often seem to have conversations that sound like that. We start with this. We start with an extremely built up environment already, right? That is, and it was built up over a long period of time and under very different conditions. We start up, and this is just a census figure, 524,246 existing housing units, right? Census. 54.4 of them are owner-occupied. They're in various states of repair and disrepair. Right? And in various balances of use and exchange value. Right? And some of it was created under very specific conditions in different time periods and often under very exploitative conditions. And it's actually some of the neighborhoods that were created in those time periods that are under the most threat today. They are our most vulnerable populations and neighborhoods. So I want to, let's just talk about the neighborhoods for a minute, right? And I'm gonna, and let's just, like, old maps. I'm a geographer, I love maps, right? So I want to look at the neighborhoods, north, south, east, and west, right? And let's look at how they were created, because it's fantastic. It's such an interesting process. So let's go north, right? Beacon Hill. And I'm sorry it's sideways, I have to have north at the top. So Beacon Hill, right? Fabulous neighborhood. And it's right up here. I don't think my pointer's working. No, it's not, but it's up there. It's to the north, right? There it is today. Fabulous housing stock. We love this. We love this housing. Right? And here's the deeds, right? And so when it was created, it said that you couldn't have tents on your property, right? And the houses had to cost at least $1,500, right? $1,500. And it also said that no person of any Negro blood should immediately be rejected from this neighborhood. They're not allowed in this neighborhood. Still on North Haven, another neighborhood, it's actually now part of Beacon Hill. Also, we're still on the north, right? Up, it's at the top of the map there. Cute little housing stock. We love this, right? Another one, just beautiful. Also, lots of restrictions, right? In this one, houses had to cost at least $5,000, right? They had to be set back 25 feet from the street, right? And then they should never, under any circumstances, any portion of this house, ever been sold to anyone of Mexican or Negro blood, right? So more of our northern neighborhoods. Let's go south, right? South, Carbondale's fabulous neighborhood, right? Fabulous, right? There it is. There's the original plat. There's the housing stock, right? There's been some urban renewal in the area. Nobody with TB. No, you can't sell wine. No open air structures. No Negroes or Mexicans, right? There was north, south. Let's go east. Dignity Hill, right? Beautiful neighborhood. We love this neighborhood. It's rapidly gentrifying. It's really, really, really beautiful housing stock. It also was racially restricted, so much that you can actually see it in the census, right? New Braunfels, dividing line from between one neighborhood to another. One neighborhood in the 1940 census, completely white. Across the street, neighborhood, completely African American, and a little bit of Mexican as well. That was east. Let's go west, right? Let's go to the west side. Prospect Hill. Prospect Hill, a wonderful neighborhood on the west side, right? They're great, fabulous housing stock. Also, this stuff is in there, right? West side, north, south, east, west. Right? We, all of these neighborhoods that are being built up have these restrictions in them. This one, no Negroes, $1,000, setbacks, all of this. So I'm really curious then, if these are the conditions when our neighborhoods started to get built up, right? And all of these, right? These are neighborhoods that we and a friend of mine have been working in. All of these red, we're just trying to trace them. What's going on then in here? and in here. To the north, most of it has been removed. It's now mostly commercial property. But what's going on in those neighborhoods that didn't show up on those plat maps? Right, let's go look at some of those. And let's look at this first. The red, you see the red? Those are restricted areas. Those were neighborhoods that had housing restrictions in them. And across the street, the areas that aren't marked, they did not. Right, so like these areas up in there, no restrictions, those did. Now I want you to look carefully at these, right? Zooming in. Look at the lots. Private pieces of private property, right? Look at the lots, look at the difference. From this, restricted, right? Angle only, to this, non-white neighborhood, right? And think for a second about the houses that could go here and the houses that could go here. The accumulation of wealth here versus the accumulation of wealth here, right? What do those places look like? And we know this, we live this. There's the plats. These were small developments. They didn't go in 1,000 to a couple hundred houses at a time. They went in 10 or 20. They were small little developments, right? This little one called the Big Five block, right? Just looking at one little house, no deed restrictions. No restrictions in these. These were open to the community of the 1920s, 30s, and 40s, right? This is the street. These are the streets. It's dense. And the infrastructure is not the same that I was showing you before. This is the little house, right? And this is the neighborhood. It's by the 1940 census. It's very mixed racially, right? So it's African American and Mexican American and Chinese and Italian and Russian, and then some people from Louisiana and Oklahoma. but these are the neighborhoods, right? These are the neighborhoods, these little neighborhoods. These are Colonia, San Ignacio, right? These also with little tiny lots. Right, that lent themselves to a very different kind of housing stock. It's a small house, it's a humble house, right? And it's a very dense neighborhood. It's a very different kind of land use. And we do this over and over again. We see evidence of this in our east, in a lot of our west side neighborhoods. In other parts of town, these have been demolished. A lot of them are gone. But these are the neighborhoods that now are extremely vulnerable, right, to future. This is a street, that's not an alley, right? There's a street sign right there, people, and I can't read the other side. These are the old streets in the unrestricted neighborhoods, right? I'm like the 6 foot tall white woman. I know, but what, like the family history that I benefited from. Because the housing in those restricted areas with the larger lots and the more standardized housing, that was open to me. But to non-whites, those opportunities were not available through 1950 of the 20th century. 1948, this stuff is declared unconstitutional. But by then, the landscape and the pattern of neighborhoods had been created. It had been set in the ground itself in terms of private property. And then you're not getting to accumulate wealth through our homes, right? I could go on like this forever, and I promise I won't. I decide this is what I do, right? I find plats, and then I go find houses. But this is the thing: is that as we got more standardized with our planning and with our development, those areas and those new neighborhoods that were being put in were restricted, right? And the non-white population got pushed into some other parts of town on smaller pieces of property. And then we're able to build smaller housing, right? And then this is what they then have been able to accumulate wealth based on. So all of these neighborhoods that I've checked in here were all racially restricted. And it's these other areas that I'm really curious about. And again, just to look at the property itself, right? And how much smaller and what kind of housing it's gonna lend itself to, right? In those areas. By the 1930s, the federal government is getting involved. All of that stuff is on a very local level between your personal developer and you. By the 1930s, the federal government gets involved, and they redline. They literally do redline these older parts of town that I've been just talking about. The smaller housing stock, the non-white neighborhoods are redlined and thus denied investment into the future up until about 1968 with President Johnson. So if we start to put some of this together, what you'll notice is the areas that were highly racially restricted, they were green or blue line, meaning that they were safe investments for the banks. But the areas that weren't restricted, right, that were non-white, smaller pieces of property, they're red and yellow lined, meaning not a safe investment. And so no investment dollars came into those for decades. Also, though, some areas, like on the east, you can see it on the east and the west sides, some racially restricted neighborhoods actually get kind of bundled into the redlining, and they also have seen more deterioration, especially if you think about the west side. They've seen more deterioration in the latter parts of the 20th century. On top of that, right, that's just the housing story, but on top of that, our social service that is most tightly intertwined with housing is schools, right? We complain today that we have, 16 different school districts? Up until the 1950s, we had 68. Those were the old common school districts. And in the 1950s, they began to consolidate into the 16 that we have today and that we continue to complain about. But those were the old ones. Those were the common school districts. They were underneath county governance. And they began to consolidate. And what I want you to remember is where all of these old neighborhoods were and that had been so racially restricted. Right? And so we consolidate into the school districts that we see today, but we did it along racial lines, very much so. Right? So that when we drew those lines, those highly racialized neighborhoods everybody was aware of that. Everybody was aware of the property values that different areas of town were contributing into these new school districts. And they were consolidated, really kind of gerrymandered around some of those old neighborhood lines. So at this point, those old relationships get concretized, institutionalized into the school districts themselves. And now we begin to think about real social services and opportunity. So by the 1950s, what have we done? We've created a highly differentiated social geography. Right, based on race, which is also based on income, under incredibly exploitative circumstances and processes, and then it was the 1960s, and we got enlightened, right? We got enlightened, and we brought equality. We brought equality to all, and then we said, we're done. We've done it. Equality, right? Right? We did it, and what does equality look like? In our educational system, it was Brown versus Board, Robin Hood, and then it was Teaks, Toss, Tax, and Star. Right? We will treat everyone the same. Right? We're going to set up this landscape, and then we're going to treat everybody the same. In public investment, it was rough proportionality. Right? We've got a city budget, let's divide it by 10, and everybody gets the same, because we're all equals. Right? Even in political engagement, I argue that direct democracy also does this a little bit. Because we expect everybody to have the same voice, yet we know that they don't. So what's the cumulative impact of all of this? Status quo. Total status quo. We bring equality to an unequal landscape. That just means that we maintain the status quo that we built in the first place. And we produce an incredibly inequitable society in the meantime that once again is very, very vulnerable. So if we look at current maps of income, right, just an income map. The lighter colors meaning lower income. We're looking at these old private property relationships. Those folks in these inner city neighborhoods that were then redlined have never been able to accumulate wealth. And we wonder, as far as, well, why do we have such economic segregation? Right? Here's for the data geeks, including myself. An area on the west side had been red line, yellow line, green line, and blue line, right? And this is looking at housing values, right, over to 2010 to 2015. What it means is that those, I'm coding in brown, those houses that are appreciating at a rate less than the county mean, right? And in blue, houses that are appreciating at a rate that's higher or above the county mean, right? This is 2015. This is decades and generations past deed restrictions and redlining. But look, in the redlined areas, the houses are appreciating significantly lower, at a value lower than the county mean. In the green areas that were racially restricted and then greenlined by the banks, they're appreciating. Your house, your most valuable asset, your savings account is appreciating much more quickly than the county mean. Yes, this was illegal. It was made illegal a long time ago, but it still haunts us. And these are some of our most vulnerable neighborhoods now. Yes, the housing has decayed and deteriorated, but the use value is still so high and so strong. So we read headlines like this one, just from last year, for the past 50 years, 78207, defined by poverty, inequality, sheer lack of opportunity. You go, well, yeah, I hope so. We created it that way. We created it as a labor reserve. It's still a labor reserve. Yeah, of course it is, right? So part three, what are we doing? What are we doing? We inherited this. We inherited this landscape, and what do we do? Right? And then we get back to this. The mayor's task force, availability, affordability, gentrification, and displacement. And I look at those words, right? I look at those words, and I type them again. And how do I understand that? Do I understand it as a spectrum? Like from availability to affordability to gentrification to displacement? Do I understand them as independent of one another? Or as an evolution, right? And does it matter? It matters because each one of those words has a different geography. Each one of those words has different policy implications, right? And they overlap. In some neighborhoods, they overlap. And they really are a spectrum. They're not individual things. So just really quickly, and I promise, almost done with the maps. Let's go to Main Park, another neighborhood, a lovely neighborhood. We love this neighborhood, right? Original plat from Mankin Park, I can't get over old plats, I love them. 1919, who what, right? There it is today, Mankin Park, like I'm doing my map thing, right? Sorry about the pole in the middle of the picture. What's this, it's like so, why did I take a pole in the middle of the picture? There's Mankin Park, right? Just beautiful. Love it. Just like the mesquite trees. Oh, love it. Houses along Mankin Park, right along Mankin Park, right? Zoo at one end, Tampa Gardens at the other. Little humble houses, you know? Just little humble houses, little Texas houses, like my pink house. Beautiful little houses, right? Very valuable property. There's the big Mankin Park today, the whole neighborhood association. Here's what's really so interesting about a neighbor, an old neighborhood like this. Because we talked today about what are our goals, what should neighborhoods look like. Look at this. The pink is single family houses and the blue is multifamily. It's all mixed up, right? It's all mixed up. Well, that's interesting. And so we've got like these beautiful single family homes built a long time ago, right? Just solid and appreciating. Sometimes quicker than people would like. And then we have the fourplexes, right? We have fourplexes also. The cool thing, middle of the neighborhood, I don't know if it's my next picture, well, kind of. There's a school in the middle of the neighborhood, right? So kids living in the fourplexes, kids living in the single family house, could go to the same school, right? This is mixed income. This is mixed income on a neighborhood scale, right? It's housing values, and the lighter colors from 20 to 100, right, I know it's a big range, but there is a large range in the neighborhood, to the dark colors, which are four into the 500s, and that's all near the Botanical Society, or mixed income, right? Mixed income, that's such a goal, right? And so again, we have the solid single family homes, and we have this in the middle, you know, just middle Texas houses that we love. Then we have the fourplexes. So that a family can age in the same neighborhood. This is a model, right? But this is what's happening, is that the fourplexes are being demolished, right? All these fourplexes are being demolished. And we are building, and these are $300,000, single family. So we're taking out affordable housing. We're building not affordable homes. That's four families are out. One family is welcomed back, but those fourplexes were $1,000 a month. That means a median salary in San Antonio. These mean a lot higher salary in San Antonio. We need to think about it. We need to think about our vulnerabilities here. So when I look at that from availability and affordability to gentrification and displacement, the mayor is so careful with his words. He's very intentional with his words. And I think we need to think about the words very, very deeply. So housing in neighborhoods, right? Our houses are savings bank, but it hasn't always been for everyone. And so we struggle with issues of inequality and income segregation. A lot, because it goes back to private property and the distribution of private property. And so we need to return to our core values, right? The mission of the city itself is prosperity, and prosperity for all, right? And it's those inner city neighborhoods that are so about vulnerable today that we need to remind ourselves, like, how were they created, right? Why hasn't some of our population been able to accrue wealth like others have, right? We want to say, work hard. We need to understand, we need to take ownership of our story. And we are not unique, it's not our story only. I'm not from here. I'm from there, right? I'm from Rochester, New York, but I love this city. I love this city, right? And I love people, but you know what? I was thinking about that. I love, like, communities of people even better than individual people. Neighborhoods, right? It's neighborhoods. Like, that's my neighbor. That's where I grew up, right? It's about neighborhoods. And still, we hold on to those old pictures of our neighborhood, right? Because it contextualizes us. I think of those fancy pictures from the mall about, like the little balls. No, because it wasn't me. I held on to this picture because it reminds me that neighborhood is deep in me. And so we need to think house. We also have to think neighborhood. And just really finally, last night as I prepared, I went to the refrigerator and I saw the little magnet on the refrigerator door. My daughter drew this when she was in preschool, right? She's 23 now. So she drew that 20 years ago, the little drawing. And what did she choose to draw when they asked her, make a magnet for your mom? She drew a house, right? And then I still have the house. Out of all of her artwork, I still have the little house, right? That's what I leave you. That's what I leave you. Thank you for choosing me to give your inaugural talk. I don't know if that's what you expected.
To have this presentation in minutes of these meetings and several other documents. We are working very closely with the city staff to develop that, and so once that is available, we will make sure that we announce it broadly. So if you're interested in I also wanted to mention that Mayor Ron Nuremberg had to leave early. As he mentioned, he was not feeling well, but he also reminded me that he's entrusting us to continue guiding this process. And to the extent that he can join some of these meetings, he will, but he's basically tasked us with coming up with a comprehensive policy document, a framework, in the next 6 months. And I think we're all very committed and dedicated to doing everything possible to ensure that we deliver on that request. So he wanted to extend, basically let everyone know that he meant to leave early. So thank you, Christine. Thank you very much. So we're going to move on to the agenda, and the next item on the agenda is really an opportunity for us to have a conversation among the task force. And at some point, you know, during the agenda, we do have the opportunity for questions and answers from the audience. So at this point, we're on item number 5, which is developing a collective vision and mission statement. And I'm going to essentially sort of set this up, and I'm going to turn it over to each of my task force members to walk us through this portion. And I'll start off by sharing with you, do you want to go to values? I'll start off by sharing with all of you that this is a process that I don't think has ever been done before, at least at this level. Having to come up with a very high-level policy framework that is all-inclusive, it's a heavy lift, and we recognize that. And because we recognize that, we want to be very thoughtful about how we carry ourselves through this process. And we come at this first by identifying the values that each of us have, or the values that we each embrace. So we had an opportunity to have what I will call a planning meeting, or organizational meeting, and have an opportunity to discuss what values as a task force do we embrace, and do we want to ensure guide this process. So we've come up with the set of values, which include collegiality, transparency, being inclusive, ensuring that we are focused on embracing equity, both in terms of how we carry ourselves, but also in terms of the approach and the process that we're engaged in, and that there's a commitment to excellence, to engagement, to innovation, holding each other accountable, and building a sense of teamwork. I think, these are very sort of common values that organizations, agencies, community groups, normally embrace, and we want to be very clear that this is how we plan to conduct this task force. And so let me ask the task force members, do any of you have any comments on that? Right, okay, next. The next homework that actually assigned to each of our my colleagues here in preparation for this meeting, I thought it would be really helpful to have us each think about the vision and mission statement that basically summarizes or crystallizes the effort. Earlier from Dr. Drennan, you saw the vision statement for the city. You heard from the mayor, and he shared his overall vision. But we also think that as a task force, it's really important that we collectively come up with a vision statement and a mission statement that will enable us to always sort of check back to ensure that we are conducting ourselves and holding each other accountable to fulfill the vision and mission statement that we have developed. So the homework for each task force member was, come up with your vision statement, keep it short, inspirational or aspirational, and then also come up with a mission statement. And I know it's difficult to read, but these are the vision and mission statements that each task force member develop independently. My name is Rosales at the top, and I'll just maybe briefly read a couple of them. Maria, this is my eyesight. It's good.
It's on your hand.
Oh, it's on my hand. Okay. Yeah. It might be better for me over here. Maria, vision. A city where all people live in healthy neighborhoods and where housing is decent, safe, stable, and affordable. Where people have a right to place and to a meaningful participation in decisions that impact the places where they live. Let's jump to Noah, who will read his mission statement. To gather information from San Antonio residents, housing stakeholders, and housing experts to develop recommendations for the creation of housing policies for San Antonio to be a city of the future. The recommendations will be comprehensive and compassionate that will allow for all residents to live with dignity, that encourages investment, and that preserves heritage of neighborhoods. And then Jim Bailey.
I didn't quite do my homework. I sort of combined.
You got a C on this
one. Yeah.
That's why he has an
architect. That's right.
Jim's mission was, we will challenge rising costs and historic inequality, preserve, oh, did I miss something?
It was just inequity.
Inequity, I'm sorry, thank you. Preserve our cultural resources and neighborhoods and create a policy framework that provides access to opportunity, education, transportation, and good health with safe, decent, and affordable housing for all. And I'll skip over her name, I'll come back. Let's see, Jean Dawson. I'm going to read both of yours because you're from very short, Jean. Is that right? To the point. Vision. Ensure all San Antonians have access to safe and affordable housing delivered through a sustainable system. Mission. The Housing Policy Task Force will develop housing policy by assessing the need, establishing priorities, developing public and private sector responses, and measuring results. And then just the last one, I'll just read the vision under the vision that I've proposed here is San Antonio leads the nation in creating healthy neighborhoods, connected communities, and in shared prosperity. Everyone has a place to call home. So these are the vision and mission statements that we all came up with. But for the purposes of the task force, of course, we think that it's really important that we come up with a collective vision statement and a collective mission statement. So I'm going to hand it over to Maria and Jim to guide us through this next portion that eventually will lead to the presentation of our draft vision and mission statement.
Well, I actually just kind of collated this stuff. I think this was really all Maria working late at night, so maybe
okay. Well, what I did was something very simple from my school. I put together a list of all the themes that each of us had on vision and mission, and just made a list of them. And then I was asked, when I shared that I had done this, I was asked to put it together and create one vision and one mission out of all of them. Well, I accepted, and my aim was to include everybody's statement, because when you look at all of it together, it was so complete. I was really proud that we had, five people to produce something, and that it all came together. So that's what became our vision and our mission. I did make a copy of what I did. I think it's there. There it is. So that includes everything that each member contributed. And they all agreed that their particular input was there. And you want me to read it?
That would be great.
Yeah.
Okay. This is the vision statement that includes what each one of us contributed. Some of them were repeated, and that's healthy neighborhoods was repeated. repeated, and the works for all was repeated to us. San Antonio will be a place of opportunity for all, current and future residents, where people have a right to place and to meaningful participation in decisions that impact the places where they live. Everyone will have a place to call home. The city will lead the nation in creating healthy neighborhoods, connected communities, and shared prosperity. Housing will be decent, safe, affordable, and stable, delivered through a sustainable system. There will be collaborative efforts between public and private sector to ensure that affordable housing alternatives are available throughout our city. Policies will exist that create access to education, transportation, and preserve neighborhood and cultural resources. And I think this is really important that as we start, we all have an understanding of what the issues are. And I was grateful for Christine's presentation because I think this is the next step. She was asking, what do we do? Well, at least we have a shared vision that we want to present to the community. That's why it's a draft.
And I do want to reiterate on that point, Maria, that our intention is to bring this community vision statement to all of you and many others who couldn't be here today to weigh in, to help us add or delete or shorten a vision statement, because ultimately we recognize that this is, when we say collective, we mean this is a vision statement that we all hold and embrace. So our commitment to all of you is that you will have a say and participate and provide input in the final statement, final vision statement, and the final mission statement. We are currently working towards getting that community meeting organized and scheduled. And so as soon as we have dates, we're also committed to making sure that we're providing ample notice so that all of you can make the proper arrangements to join us. But thank you for reminding us that this is our draft to the community, and we look forward to receiving input as we finalize this.
And also that we're working on civic engagement process.
Right.
We haven't quite got that. It's not just one meeting.
Thank you. So then the draft community mission statement, do you want to read that, Maria? Do you want to ask one of our colleagues here to? All right, Jim.
Well, this was another one of, sorry, this is my microphone. This is another one of Maria's wordsmithing efforts, but I'll read it. So this is the draft community mission statement. The Mayor's Housing Policy Task Force will lead a policy-making process grounded in community data and best practices that will address the full spectrum of housing. The process will include a commitment to inclusive community engagement that will engender trust. The collaborative decision-making process will gather information from San Antonio residents, housing stakeholders, and housing experts that will contribute to and result in comprehensive and compassionate recommendations that allow for all residents to live in dignity. The task force will assess the need, establish priorities, assure the equitable distribution of resources, and encourage investment that preserves the heritage of our neighborhoods. It will challenge rising housing costs and historic inequity. Develop public and private sector responses, measure results, and advance meaningful opportunity strategies. The task force recognizes that San Antonio prospers when we foster healthy, resilient, sustainable, economically integrated neighborhoods by preserving affordable housing, expanding housing supply for all, preventing displacement of low-income residents, and building infrastructure that increases connectivity and mobility.
Are there any comments from, any additional comments on this? So moving on to the next item that we wanted to also discuss and share with all of you here tonight. Moving on to the next item that we are prepared to share with all of you tonight. The mayor was very specific about letting us know that he's expecting to see something in 6 months. And we're all prepared and committed to deliver on that. To that end, we created this preliminary timeline. regular meetings. At this point, we are looking to have meetings every 2 weeks. For now, we're planning to have these meetings every Tuesday. The start time will be at 5:30, because we recognize that, you know, it's important to ensure that we have maximum participation in these meetings. And our next meeting, we're planning to have on October the 17th, but stay tuned for more information. We want to coordinate with the city to make sure that that date works in terms of the availability of space and staff and resources. But the task force will be meeting every 2 weeks, and we will pretty much conduct our meetings in this fashion. Although I do think that because it's a working task force, we probably will be gathering closer together and, you know, looking at information and maybe not have as much of this formality tonight, because I think it is important for us to feel comfortable and to be engaged. But definitely the formality in terms of having mics, making sure that you are all able to participate, making sure that these meetings are recorded and so forth. The next piece is the technical working groups, and I'll ask Jim to chime in on describing the concept for the technical working groups.
Yeah, sure. So since this is a comprehensive housing policy framework, we're being tasked with looking at kind of all aspects of housing up and down the supply chain. You know, looking at, you know, the bucket of issues surrounding gentrification and you know, neighborhood integrity, the bucket of issues surrounding the provision of new housing, you know, labor availability, rising construction costs, financial products that are available. So there's a wide range of issues that we're going to need to tackle. And we've been engaged over the last month or so kind of thinking about those in broad terms. Our hope is that we'll get some help from our advisors and our consultants to narrow down what those buckets are, and those will be assigned to technical working groups to tackle initially that are made up of experts and community stakeholders.
Right. And the next line is technical and housing policy advisors. And I'm going to ask maybe Noah to walk us through this, piece.
And I'll do my best to do this. It was a short conversation that we had when we looked over this chart. But as we envisioned the technical and housing policy advisors, and that's really finding the experts in each field that impacts housing, from the construction of new housing to the rehabilitation of old housing stock. The individuals that do the work day to day that are faced with the challenges of doing that work and understand what it takes to get a project from A to Z. And so those are the individuals that we want to task to bring us their inputs so we can use those inputs to develop our policies.
Thank you, Noah. And Jean, do you want to go ahead and describe the role of the city staff? And really, you know, I also want to, maybe before I turn it over to you, Jean, just I want to recognize again, you know, both the mayor staff and the city manager staff. Marisa Bolo, as the chief of policy, has been incredible. Juan Gómez, you know, has been really guiding and helping us think through the community engagement process. The mayor's chief of staff, Trey Jacobson, also been really instrumental, along with Victoria Gonzalez, who works in the mayor's office. And so I can't thank you enough on behalf of the task force for your support. And, you know, Cheryl, to you and to Peter and to Veronica Soto, our newest addition to the city. She's the director of neighborhoods and housing services. We look forward to working very closely with you, Veronica, and with your team as we, you know, continue this process. So I'm going to turn it over to you. Did I steal your thunder? I'm sorry.
No. I don't know what else you can say, but we are going to rely very heavily on city staff, and the managers put together a very strong group, and we think that we can lean very heavily into the existing city staff, and we look forward to either being led or leading with the city staff. And
certainly can't do it without any citizens.
And if I may add, Jim, you can add also this, the work that the housing commission was doing, city staff has done an enormous amount of work already to that area, to that side, that they're not creating really yet.
No, we're not starting on.
They're really ahead of us.
Yes, that's actually a very important point. A lot of the information and data and reports that we will be using are really grounded in the work that has been done from SC 2020 to SC Tomorrow, to the work that the housing commission is doing. And also, you know, to the work that many housing providers are doing across the city, whether they be nonprofit, the housing authority, or, you know, for-profit housing providers. And so that leads us to the last item in terms of the timeline, the community engagement piece. And I'll have Maria Arreguzaba, if you can just describe the community facilitation and community engagement process.
Well, like we have mentioned, several of us already, that we do want to have community participation. And we would like to have, or we will have, an entity, a facilitator, that will help us create that community engagement piece. And we realize that to reach to the client or the customer, which is anybody who lives in a house, home, or apartment, it's we have a diverse community. So the outreach has to be sensitive to the cultural diversity, language situation of our city. So I'm looking forward to this piece. To see how we can engage the community in what we're doing. That all the people that I mentioned in my initial statement that work in their neighborhoods, in their neighborhood associations, in their community groups, in their block, neighborhood watch, any individual who's interested so that they can be engaged in the process.
Thank you. So this is our draft timeline. We will very likely revisit this timeline anytime we meet, just to track our progress. We probably will make a few changes around some of our amendments. And this, you know, presentation also will be online as soon as we can make that happen. And so now we move into the next item on our agenda, which is an opportunity to hear from those of you that are here with us in the audience. We do have a Q&A portion. This is really an opportunity for you to ask questions in regards to what has been presented today. And we do have individuals that are walking around with mics. If you require interpretation services, we also have those services available. And I would maybe just ask if anyone that has questions, if you want to just come up close, that would be great. Thank you.
My name is Ray Alexander. I reside in and I represent the Hot Wells Mission Reach Neighborhood Association. In regards to the proposed locations in the affordable housing bond, my question is, whether a neighborhood association chooses to support or oppose a project within their area, will you support a policy that honors the association's position?
Thank you for that question. And I think it's too difficult for at least for me, say a yes or no answer, because just as we heard today in terms of the presentation, there are a lot of different factors that have to be considered with regard to the housing. And so, you know, it is really important for neighbors to be engaged, to be involved, to be at the table, to have a voice in what is occurring within their community. But I also think that, you know, oftentimes there's not enough information that is provided to neighborhood associations. And that's not the fault of a neighborhood association.
board that they receive enough information to make sort of informed decisions. So we will revisit this throughout the process. Very much appreciate you bringing this to, you know, to this meeting. Thank you again for your question. Any other task force members?
Yeah, I would have to understand exactly what the particular process is, Mr. Alexander. What rules have been set up, what has been done before, and then I can make my decision. The easiest thing for me would be sure, you know, but I'm not going to do that until I know, what rules have been created. And sometimes it's an issue of adjusting, tweaking, improving the criteria for how decisions are going to be made, and I would have to understand that.
I think the question does highlight, you know, we're a policy task force. And so we will be establishing a framework that those kind of decisions will be made. We will not be making those specific kind of decisions. We will not be designating certain neighborhoods at a task force level. But certainly in establishing policy, we will want the framework that future decisions can be made.
Yeah, and I'll just follow up on that. You know, there's a kind of significant and sustained effort within the city of San Antonio right now to begin to address infill kind of at a larger scale, both through the Office of Historic Preservation and the folks in zoning and planning. So it's a much larger conversation, and I can't give you a blank black and white answer to that question in a void. I think it's context specific. I think it's detail specific, and I think it's neighborhood specific. And my hope is that this larger conversation is going to begin to inform the answer to that important question over the next couple of years.
My position.
Ray Alexander, District 3.
Yes, hello, Edward Castor. I'm in Council District 8. I've been a homeowner since 1993. My wife and I have. I live in the confluence of District 6, 7, and 8. And as far as policy is concerned, from what I've looked on online about 30 minutes before I came here, all the issues that I saw, housing, it all ties in with transportation and solutions for transportation for growing communities like ourselves. One of the things that I would suggest to y'all is a funding source for our transportation issues is I saw that one of these communities, they were tying in these developments. They were having a fee paid by those developers, and those dollars were specifically for transportation. So that is a suggestion I would give to y'all, because with all this infill and gentrification of the downtown community, you know, I see that we're giving away a lot of tax abatements and federal tax credits. Well, we need to get something out of that to help solve our transportation issues, because housing and transportation, they all go together. So thank you.
Thank you for that. And I wanted to acknowledge that tonight we have looked back, a member of the VIA Board of Trustees, Mr. and Dr. Richard Gambetta. Thank you so much for being here. And I would, you know, wholeheartedly agree that as we look at housing, we need to ensure that we are tying housing to transportation, that we understand the opportunities that are afforded when we think about transit oriented development. So thank you, and we hope to see you at these meetings, particularly when we hone in on the discussion
of our country. And of course, our vision statement specifically mentions connectivity and transportation, so we agree.
I think there's someone in the back.
I can run over there. Go
ahead.
Okay. Good evening. I'm Homer Hayes. I'm with the Manatee Park Neighborhood Association and District 2 representative. And I'm very, very optimistic, having been here tonight. And to help you, we have from the Manatee Park Neighborhood Association a white paper on housing, which I'd like to get to each of you if you'd like.
Yes, thank you.
So, can I get out here and ask you a question?
My question is, will you please read it?
Absolutely.
Thank you.
I want to thank, I think there's several people around here that since I got named to the task force have been calling me, sending me emails. I've met with a couple of people, and also I even had a group of people put a packet together and deliver it to my front porch. And I'm really grateful to the people, and I just want to assure them that I will, I have read everything, try to contact the people who send me the information, and that I will continue to do this. And that we need more of this, the actual statements from people. You know, if we have, let's say, citizens to be heard, you speak for 3 minutes, that's good, but it's better if we can actually have for those people who can do it to give us statements like this. So I'm very thankful to you.
I'm Sharice Maradrini. I'm from District 1, and I live in the Malacca neighborhood. I wanted to follow up on the transportation and ask you to make sure you consider not just vehicle transportation, but foot and bike as well. With infill development, which we welcome, there's also the added pressure of sidewalk use, which our old neighborhoods haven't really adapted for. So I want to make sure that we consider that. And we talk about infrastructure, so make sure that we don't forget the foot infrastructure, especially in our urban core. And related to that, a lot of what I heard health a few times, which I'm thrilled about because I work in public health, we spent the last 5 months or so on the Community Health Improvement Plan, which addressed some of these issues and not specifically related to housing, but a lot of the infrastructure issues that are connected to housing. So rather than a question, I have a request that we make sure that we do not work in silence and look at some of the concepts that came up with the Community Health Improvement Plan related to safe communities as we discuss our housing.
Great, thank you. Maria, did you want to add something?
One of the things that we have been doing is as we find articles, reports in the on the internet, we've been sending them to each other. We haven't discussed them or anything, we're just sharing them. But we already have reports that were done by the city of, was it Oakland? Who had a housing process with health system. There's another one that did housing with health and transportation. Another one and education. So we have these individuals who we hope will help us with a very broad and bold look at the big picture, not just housing, but housing in relation to education, housing in relation to health, housing in relation to transportation, and you know, individually, we have ideas on how we want that to happen, but your point is very well taken.
I also want to mention that I have had to create a binder to keep track of all of these documents because I like to read things and write on them. And so many of these documents are things that you know my peers here have shared. That particular article on health is really a great article. And so I think as we think about the web page for the task force, to the extent that you know we identify resources that might be helpful to continue the conversation, we'll you know be selective and try to do that. That it's actually more than an article. It's an entire compilation of innovative models in health and housing. A very good piece that was prepared by Mercy Housing and the Low Income Investment Fund for the California Endowment Fund and the Cressy Foundation. So we'll also try to make that available.
My name is Lynn Ortega, and I am the housing co-chair for the Casa Metro organization. Casa Metro have been involved with housing for many, many years. So we applaud the mayor's decision for this task force. We expect great work from you. We will be working with you. We'll be sitting down with you, we have to. We have heard so much about the decade of the neighborhood of the downtown. Well, let me tell you, now it's time for the decade of the neighborhood.
Right. Thank you.
It's my phone. It's my mom and my dad.
Yeah, my name is Graciela Sanchez, and apologies for the interruption. Was it 4 years ago when the 300 folks were displaced from Mission Trail?
2015.
2015, so only 2 years ago? No. 3 or 4 years ago, 300 folks were displaced. And those individuals were the most passionate group of people that I've actually ever worked with in the last few years. And all the stereotypes I have of people living in trail homes, you know, got blown away when I went and visited and shared coffee with them. And it reminded me of growing up in the historic West Side that I grew up in that also got destroyed in the 1970s with urban renewal. And because of that displacement, Julian Castro starts this mayor's task force. And here we are. Did you say 4 years ago? Oh. So years later, and what happened to that task force and all those recommendations? What I've seen is, were there any policies put in place? What I do know is, that housing values continue to go up. My first home in the Lavaca area, which I bought for $27,000, is now valued at $200,000. And I didn't, when I bought that house, it was I can afford that as a, with a $30,000 or $24,000, you know, income that I was bringing in at that time was probably $24,000. The house that I now live in that I bought for $70,000 went up over $150,000 in land value in just 1 year, and I'm fighting that. So what are the policies that are going to be created, right? It went from, I bought it for $70,000, it's over $250,000 this year. And I've been fighting that. And I have a college education, and I know how to speak and write in English, and I'm fierce. But there's so many of our people that don't even know that they can go and fight their county. And I'm still going to lose, but I'm going to make it a point to fight. And now HUD has this last opportunity before Trump shuts down the funding for future HUD money. And so SOP HUD is going fast track to get this $30 million from SOP HUD to essentially demolish the Alazan courts. 501 units, over 1,200 people will be displaced. And according to Saha, their good record in Wheatley was bringing back 20% of those Wheatley folks back to the new beautiful housing. And so everything that they develop is only for 20%. If we say it's 20% for Alazan, that's going to be 240 people that get to come back for whatever. So how do we develop the policies before we see the displacement of our communities, from those folks who live in public housing to individuals like myself, you know, who aren't, you know, even doing well off financially, but, you know, won't be able to stay in my neighborhood, much less the viejitos who live there.
I just wanted to mention that many of the themes and the issues that you have brought are issues that we're all very keenly aware of, and we do hope that through this process we will have an opportunity, not just simply as a task force, but through the technical working groups, to advance a set of policy recommendations to the mayor, to the city council, and I have to also acknowledge and recognize our city council members. Many of them are very engaged and involved in addressing some of these issues.
Good afternoon. Selena Santibanez Gipsit. I am a resident of District 2, specifically Harvard Place East Lawn. And so a couple of things that I just want to point out and really just bring to attention. It was mentioned of labor availability. One, as a small business owner to a construction company, we're going to have a shortage of skilled labor to actually build these homes. And that's something that we should look at now. With everything going on between deportation and Harvey and everybody leaving to build housing there, where are we going to get our skilled labor from? So just be cognizant of that. Second of all, I once again live in Harvard Place East Lawn. This is a neighborhood whose median income range is $17,000. And a house went for sale or got renovated. It was a former crack house. Went on for sale for $250,000 on the market. It would take 10 families to afford that one house. And that house is accessible to a family that could walk their child to Washington Elementary. And so now that house went from $250,000. It got dropped down to $215,000. And now it's an Airbnb property. And so I made that statement because this is not the only house. I live on the cusp of New Braunfels. And so there are over 40 homes now that have been renovated for the pleasure of people to come here as Airbnb residents. So just keep all of that in mind. So between labor, transportation, health, I also lived in Portland, Oregon, where housing along the North Pacific Northwest, West, housing first. So before we can look at education, transportation, it's housing. We have to provide housing to our families and individuals. Finally, I will mention of density. I know we've looked at plots, I know we looked at lots, but when it comes to neighborhoods who are already dense to begin with, when our children, when we're expecting a million plus people to San Antonio, then what are we going to look at in terms of policy for density? Because we already have a difficult time with pedestrians, with people driving, not really paying attention to signs. I was standing up in front of my Houston Street home with my house, my sign that said, "Drive like your kids live here." And then I look down the street and then the flashlights aren't even on. So, you know, density, for all these kids that are living in these areas, what does that really mean to the overall neighborhood? And then finally, Graciela mentioned East Meadows. I actually went to Wheatley Middle School, so right across the street. Not all of that apartment complex, though mixed income, has actually brought in people. I think less than 30 families or so forth have actually moved into that property. And that was a success in many people's opinion. And so not all of those families have actually returned. And then our surrounding properties, because of the state, because of how it's been ignored for so long, what are we doing for safety in terms of housing? So thank you very much for your time, and I look forward to the future of this task force.
Thank you. Thank you very much. And I looked at Jim when you mentioned labor, because that has been a conversation that we've also had, the importance of ensuring that we're thinking about the workforce and the opportunities for skilled labor. So we're going to take one more question, because I recognize that it's two more questions, if there are two questions.
Or
because I recognize that it's,
Or maybe we could limit it to short questions, because we really are running out of time. We're going to have plenty of opportunity over the next 6 months to speak at length about all these issues.
Okay.
I'm Dorian Martinez, I'm with District 1. I particularly care to hear from Jim Bailey and Gene Dodson from Alamar Architects and Dave Dawson Engineers what particular projects you've done in regards to affordable housing, and if a developer is getting money through the city, what's the stipulation of what's affordable? Is it 20% of the housing goes to affordable? Is it 50%? What do you view as affordable? Because
sure.
The word's been used a lot tonight.
No, I got it. So there were a couple of questions in there. So what do I view as affordable? I think these days the answer to that question is almost everybody in San Antonio, roughly 70% of San Antonio, can no longer afford or are cost burdened by the product that the free market is offering. Those are some of the numbers that he offered up front. I mean, and that's our teachers, that's our firefighters, that's our, that's our police officers, that's our nurses. So it's across the board. So there's various levels of affordability that are going to require different levels of subsidy. developments I've done, well, I've done close to 20,000 units over the last 12 years, and 80% of them have been affordable. I've worked on the entire redevelopment of San Juan for San Antonio Housing Authority. I've worked on various phases of Victoria Commons, and literally 16,000 affordable housing units across the state of Texas.
I just want to emphasize that affordability is in stagnant. I mean, it's not just one number. Affordability is different to everybody. And so we have to create a policy that addresses every level of affordability. And I think that's going to be our an important task for us.
Thank you. Are there any other pressing questions? Okay, we're going to do Sonia, one more question, and then more opportunities to have the conversation to be part of the discussion.
Buenas tardes. Thank you for this work that we all want to engage in. I want to very briefly pick up on Dr. Brennan's comment on context and focus, which I greatly appreciate, on race and class. And so I'd like to expand that a little bit and talk about gender. And so when you get to the demographics and to all of the maps that you're going to be looking at, I would ask that in the demographics you really seriously think about gender, particularly when we're looking at public housing and we're looking at folks whose income is very low and who maybe have 2 or 3 jobs. So transportation is also an issue. But when we look particularly at public housing, the vast majority of the single-headed household families are women. And it's not clear to me that in our examination of policies in the city, including in housing, we have taken that as a very central, critical part of policy, making and policy decisions. And there are many other issues, but but gender is my field, and so I really feel compelled to bring it up every chance I get. And I'm sorry, I think I forgot to say that I'm District 1, and I'm also a founding member of the Westside Preservation Alliance, and hard work in that alliance, which I will be speaking to at some other point, is to preserve the history and culture of working class communities in the West Side and San Antonio more generally, but certainly focusing on the West Side. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much. So with that, we will wrap up our Q&A and go on to the next item on our agenda, which is just a reminder that we are working to schedule our first broad community input and stakeholder meeting. We are very hopeful that we can have this in the month of October. We will work closely with the mayor's office and city staff to basically pull all the logistics together, and we'll do everything possible to provide ample notice. Our next task force meeting is scheduled Tuesday, October the 17th at 5:30. Stay tuned for the location and for additional details. I again want to thank you all for making the time to be with us. For your questions, for your recommendations, and for the reminder that the work that we're doing is critically important. So with that, you all have a great evening and happy